Good day once again to all of you. Welcome back. And let me take you into some very basic fundamentals of life, which we are all aware of, but sometimes we tend to forget or sometimes we tend to neglect. You know, when there's a baby in the womb, the baby gets 100% attention of the whole universe. The baby knows that everything is being provided. The baby doesn't have to ask for anything, wait for anything. The baby doesn't feel any discomfort. And then the baby comes out of the womb. Once she is out, then in most cases, because it's a newborn baby, the mother or whoever it is starts giving full attention to the baby. Anything and everything that the baby needs, whatever are, you know, the baby is asking for, the baby is looking a little uncomfortable. They check out whether the baby is wet and the nappy has to be changed. They calculate and say, no, by now baby must be hungry, so we must, you know, provide the milk or whatever it is. That's how it goes. Now, in some cases, what happens is that the baby doesn't get enough attention. So a lot of these aspects of life, they start at a very early age. So in the formative age, in the initial years, somehow a child gets a feeling that I am not being given what I want or what I deserve. Then what does the child do? The child starts looking for ways and means to get what she should get. And that is what we refer to as attention-seeking behavior. I want the attention because a small child's life revolves entirely around the very few people. It could be mother, father, this, that, a few people, no? So when the child wants something, the child knows that if I seek attention, then I will get what I want. As the little child grows, the child also learns whom to get attention from. So even though, let's say, there is a aunt or a visitor or a neighbor who comes and, you know, is smiling and talking to the little child, the child knows that this one does not provide me with what I want. So the child is looking around to see where is mother. If I ask mother, then mother will get me what I want. So we start developing this, you know, feeling of wanting selective attention. Even if you're getting attention from somebody, you will see small babies or even small children that, let's say, another person, the mother says, please just take care of the baby while I go out and do something. And that other person is willing to give full attention to this little one. The little one doesn't like it. The little one starts protesting, crying, saying, no, I want attention only from the person whom I want attention from. And that, believe me, carries on and on right up to adulthood in some of the cases where we are so particular that I want only this friend. I want only this person to like me. I want the time and attention only of this person. And this, over the years now, is becoming a little more, you know, in-depth because relationships are changing. Earlier, there used to be only defined relationships. A couple of generations back, most people used to live in joint families. Particularly as a small child, most children 2-3 generations back were born, brought up in a joint family. So for any reason, a mother is not there to give attention. There would be a grandmother, there would be an aunt, there would be somebody or the other around. But if that does not happen, if the child is growing up, let's say, in a nuclear family, where the child knows that if I don't get attention from this person, there are no alternatives to me. That is what happens. So today, we start looking more and more towards undefined relationships. So even as a small child, we learn that if, you know, daddy or mommy are not giving me something, maybe I can go to the neighbor's house and put up that little puppy face and say that, you know, I want, you know, mommy not giving me. So the little one, the neighbor says, oh, poor little thing, let us give something. So slowly, slowly what happens is that the child starts learning where to get attention from. And this is what we refer to as transference. Transferring your needs or your affection to other people other than from whom you should be getting it. And once we get into that habit, we start becoming very, very conscious of where do I get this love and attention and all these things. And as we grow up, some of us start looking to see in every relationship, where am I going to get that attention and affection which I want? If I am not getting it from somebody, I start looking around. I do this transference. I start craving for love and affection. Now, if that comes from somewhere at least, okay, fine, undefined relationship, I have this person who fills in the gap of what my dear ones and my loved ones are not giving in. Anyway, I'm getting it from somebody, even then it is fine and I'm happy with it. But supposing I do not get it from anybody whom I value and who I want something from, the moment I start realizing as I'm growing up that I am not getting enough attention, I start looking for attention-seeking behavior. Take the case of a child who is going to school. The child, inevitably, particularly smaller children, they want to be teacher's pets. They want teacher to look at them, greet them, spend some time with them, appreciate them and all that. Now, let's say there is this child who likes this teacher and is craving for attention from the teacher, but the teacher is not giving. So the person does something, puts in a lot of effort and does the homework and brings it next day to the teacher. He says, okay, fine, keep it, leave it here and go. No, miss, I added this thing to the thing. Okay, I'll have a look at it later. You go and sit down. Now, if the child starts feeling that I'm not getting enough attention, what does the child do? The normal impulse is to do something whereby I get teacher's attention. Now, if I'm not standing first in the class, if I'm not that type of person who can answer all the questions, then what does it leave me with? It leaves me only with negative behavior. So I do some mischief. I don't do the homework and come. Or I start disturbing somebody sitting next to me. Or I purposely ask questions which are totally irrelevant. Now what happens? The teacher starts giving me attention. In a negative manner, the teacher is scolding me. The teacher is asking me to shut up. The teacher is even punishing me at times. But negative attention is better than no attention. That's the type of feeling that we get if we are lonely. And even if we get, lonely, even if we find that we are not getting attention, so many other factors of our life start getting, disturbed. Now, what can you do? Let's say you're a teacher with 40 children. And there are some of these children who, for whatever reason, maybe they are not getting enough love and affection at home, or maybe their friends are not giving them enough, because they don't fit into the group or for whatever the reasons. So the child is seeking attention, but the teacher has so many responsibilities. So if you are an adult dealing with children, and if you have responsibilities, and this child is continuously seeking attention, what do you do? One of the best ways is to teach the child delayed gratification by assuring the child that I will give you attention if you are willing to wait. So this child is doing some behavior, something which is obviously to attract attention. If the teacher can say, yes, I know that you want to talk to me, or I know that you would like me to spend some time or do something with you, can you wait till the break? Or can you meet me after the last period? I'll spend some time with you. Or can we meet on Saturday, because I'm comparatively very free on Saturdays and we can spend some time together. See, a lot of people who are seeking attention are willing to give up on it if they find an assurance of delayed gratification. That if I delay my gratification, I will get what I want. And this happens across the board with a lot of, you know, growing up children and even adults for that matter. But we don't realize the significance of it. So I was talking to some of my colleagues about how, you know, how things go in their family, how they find some, you know, people craving for attention, whatever happens. We just recorded a little narration by one of our colleagues, Sufia. She said, okay, I will tell you what happens in my house. Shall we listen to her?
To share a few instances what I faced with children around me, that is my own children and plus my neighboring kids and things like that. You know, at times it happens that, you know, I'm over a call or I'm talking to my mother or my husband at home. I can see that my children are playing on their own very happily. They have a good rapport with them, then they share their toys. But the moment they think that something, somewhere they are missing, you know, to focus on us, they simply start fighting. And, you know, they try to pull each other's toy and things happen like that. And most of the time, not only with children, adults do that as well. You know, appropriately when I'm engrossed in my job and I find that some me time for me, they purposefully want a cup of tea or they want to search for their handkerchief, which they can actually find it in the wardrobe, but they want me to give that. Why? Because they want that attention only for themselves. One more incident I want to share is, you know, when I do some writing for myself or I'm organizing some things at home and assorting few things in the kitchen, they purposefully come in the middle of my work, and which is actually not their lunch time or the snack time, they suddenly start feeling hungry. I'll be like, arey, maine abhi toh feed kiya tha an hour before, but why? But when I start realizing and reflect on that, I think that yes, they need me to be with along with them and give that attention to. And on the other day, there was a situation when we as a family went on a drive. It was of course after their dinner time, after their milk time and everything, we went. We thought they will, you know, doze off after some time. And myself and my husband, we were in a deep conversation. Then suddenly my younger one woke up. Purposefully she came in between us and she was like, mommy water, mommy kerchief. Why? Because she was feeling a little bit insecure that why mama and dad is talking amongst themselves. Where am I in this?
Yes, it starts sometimes in childhood. Sometimes it even happens later. I'll talk about it. See, children, sibling rivalry, as you know, that is one time when they want to have, you know, if they feel that my sibling is getting more attention than me, if they find that the teacher is giving more attention to somebody else rather than me, or like Sufia just said just now, mother is giving more attention to father than to me, and they start doing various activity. They may start sulking, they may start throwing tantrums, they may start purposely misbehaving so that, you know, they get a negative attention. Now, as the child moves on to adolescence, as you know, that is a peer age. So that's a time when the child's attention diverts from the near and dear, like teachers and the parents and all that, to peers. So now I want more attention from my peers. I don't want it. Even if mommy, daddy or teacher are giving me attention, I don't want it. I want it from my peers because I want to prove that I am worthy of my peers. They will give me that attention and all that. Now, if they don't get that, then they start, you know, this attention-seeking behavior. They start looking for someone. Often, let's say a boy or a girl acquires a girlfriend or a boyfriend. Even though the person is not unduly attached to that person or not really in love with that person, but because I know that if I have my own boyfriend or my own girlfriend, I get exclusive attention. I have that identity that I am in a relationship. I have my own boyfriend, my own girlfriend. And that is what gives a sense of a lot of, you know, a sense of security or a sense of belonging and all those things. These are, you know, really areas of very deep concern, because that's a time when the child is growing up, the child is going to become an adult. And if adolescence is not dealt with properly, if children are not given the right opportunities when they go through teenage to get what they want, to understand their own emotions, to understand their own needs and all these things, then they can sometimes even lifelong be in that state of wanting attention, wanting affection, wanting to grab from people, wanting to put other people down. These are the things that we need to understand. Now, let's say a person comes to adulthood. Once a person has come to adulthood, what happens is that either you have carried some of that gap, that thing of wanting attention from childhood, and it has not been resolved even in the adolescent years, then you carry that through. Even as an adult, you're supposed to be mature, you're supposed to be balanced, but you start doing things which are attention seeking. A person, for example, may go out of the way to butter up his boss, to get the attention, to get some praise or something from the boss so that, you know, I stand out among all my colleagues. A person may become very possessive about the spouse, because after all these years, I have grown up, I have settled down in life, and now I have acquired a life partner. Now, this person should give me all the attention that I want. I don't like it if that person is spending, a husband may say, why do you keep going to your mother's house all the time? Why do you keep talking to your mother all the time on the phone? And vice versa, the wife may say that, why are you always with your friends, or why are you always doing this? So whenever we come across these things, we need to understand that it is what we call as attention-seeking behavior, primarily because there is a gap within me. And that is what I am trying to fulfill it through these things. If you recall, in way back in 1964, Eric Byrne came out with this thing called transactional analysis. And one of the wonderful things that TA brought to us is what we call as games people play. So we start playing games, we start manipulating people because I want attention. I don't even ask for it. I don't even express that, see, I'm feeling lonely or I'm feeling left out. Can you please do this? Sometimes it's, you know, not in my ego to express that. So I will use roundabout ways. You may come across, for example, an elderly parent or an in-law who suddenly falls sick when the rest of the family is going out to enjoy themselves. It is so psychosomatic that the person actually develops physical symptoms of illness. So they are very convinced. But basically what was it? It was the mind telling the body to fall sick because I am too old to go to such and such place, and the rest of them are going and they are going to enjoy and they are going to leave me alone over here. So that's what I want you to understand, that it goes on and on and on, right up to old age. Some people become more and more of attention seeking as they grow older, because somewhere they start feeling that I have lost out on relationships. I am no longer important. A person who worked very hard to take care of his family and, you know, take care of all their needs, he went and worked and this and that, finally he retires. Now his children have taken over. They are the breadwinners. I neither am the breadwinner or the provider for the family, nor am I fit and, you know, agile enough to go running around and do things and all. So I start becoming more and more into this attention seeking behavior. The same thing happens in marriage. If a marriage does not have very good and very clear communication between the two spouses, and one of the spouses has got a vacuum for whatever the reason, this happened earlier or whatever it is, when that happens, the spouse may start making, let's say, allegations. Where were you? Why did you get so late? Why were you not here? Whom were you talking to? Whom were you with? It is not actually so much of suspicion or accusation. It is to fill in that gap that if I tell my partner that you are doing this, you are going out somewhere, I don't know what you are doing. So the person starts, giving me attention because I'm shaking up the person by making these sort of allegations. These are all things which we do at a very, subconscious level. We don't even realize it. Take a simple case of a person who inevitably has to butt in between and interrupt a conversation. Somebody is explaining something that, last week I had gone to such and such place and this happened and I wanted to share with you. Okay, after listening to the whole episode, if you have questions and if you want more details, you can ask. But the people who have this attention-seeking attitude, what they will do is, while the person is talking, they will interrupt. And many a time, the interruption is unwarranted in the sense that it is not necessary that you should get that answer at all. But that is the way of showing that everybody is focusing you. They are giving all the attention to you because you are saying something important or interesting and I'm being left out. So if I am that person who has that attention seeking, craving, even a simple thing like somebody is talking and saying something interesting, I will purposely butt in between. These are the things which I want you to keep in mind. And of course, now with the social media having come in, everybody wants the whole world to know what I am doing. They walk into a restaurant, good hot food has come. Instead of starting to eat that, they will take pictures of that food. And they will see to it that it is circulated somewhere else. There was a case I had dealt with where a gentleman had to go abroad. And the wife said, you should take me also. He said, no, I can't afford it. Company is sending me abroad and I have to go alone. I can't. No, it's such a nice place. I would have liked to come, something. They couldn't afford it. So he said, no, I can't take you. And he went there. Now, he said there also, when he was talking to her, he was telling her that I'm very busy. It's a very hectic program and I have these conferences and these and whatever meetings and all that. I'm not getting any time. It so happened that one particular day in the afternoon, just after lunch, they were told that the person who was supposed to come and interact, he's 1 hour delayed. He'll come after 1 hour. So he thought, okay, let me step out and just take a round of the environment. He went out and there was something very nice, some scenery, some beauty, some park, something, whatever it is. So he goes there. And as soon as he sees those nice things, he says, I must send it, to my loved ones. So he wanted to send it to his wife, firstly, and also to his sister. It so happened that the sister's name probably was above in his list in the phone. So the first message went to the sister. Just after he sent that message, another colleague came to him and engrossed him in a conversation. And for quite some time he was talking. And by the time they realized that we have to go back, so they went back to the venue. And he didn't even realize that he had not sent it to his wife. By the time, the sister started forwarding this thing to all the family members. And the wife came to know. There was such a ruckus, there was so much of misunderstanding on a simple thing like this. But what is the root cause? The root cause was that she wanted attention and she somehow felt I'm not getting that attention from myself. So we have to deal with it at the root cause level. Starting off with basic, things like, do I have this attention? Or my loved one, my important person, do they have this thing? Become aware of it. Don't treat it as individual incidents. No, on that day, he or she created such a racket or this. Or that day I felt very bad, so I shouted or whatever. There's a pattern. That's what I took up this topic today to help you to understand. Inevitably, there is a pattern which forms. And if you want to check out that pattern, all you have to do is for some fixed time, give full attention to that person who's seeking attention or who's, you know, making you uncomfortable. Drop everything else and give full attention. See if the behavior changes. If you see a behavior, change in the behavior, you know that primarily what he or she wanted was this. The second thing is to understand that we should learn to be complete within ourselves. We should not be relying on somebody else to fulfill whatever, you know, I want to. The third is to give ourselves rewards. Whenever I get attention or whenever I give attention, non-material rewards, positive strokes, in whatever way, you know, I can. And then start with this carrot and stick policy. When the person is good to you, be very nice. When the person is doing this whining or tantrums or trying to, you know, butt in between and all that, then use the stick. Stick in the sense of cooling off, becoming a little, you know, curt with that person, not giving enough attention to that person. The message does reach over a period of time. If we start, you know, doing that, please understand that everyone has this to greater or lesser extent. And does it cost us a lot to give attention to such a person? Not overdoing it, of course, not making the person emotionally dependent on you, but to whatever extent, if you realize whether it's a child, whether it's an adolescent, or whether it's an adult, or whether it's a senior citizen, your parent, uncle, aunt, grandfather, whatever it is, sometimes in small doses, if you can give that attention, a lot happens. So that is something very fundamental and basic that I wanted to share with you. Start looking around, become aware of the people who are seeking attention. Even be aware that, are you doing it? Maybe selectively. I'm a grown-up man, but I still want attention from my mother or father or somebody. There may be so many causes for it. If you can explore and find out the cause, nothing like it. But even if you can't do that, there is no harm if you can become aware of it and start looking for alternatives. That is what we will, you know, discuss about in the second half once I start taking up your questions and your comments. But then as I was doing this and I had invited Purnima to come and, you know, share something, I realized that something is going on between her and Sneha. I don't know what that is and why that is happening. Can you look at it and give me your comments why this is happening?
So, good afternoon. Yes, yes, yes. So, what I was trying to tell you is that,
what do you want?
I just want a hug.
You wanted a hug? There's something very important happening. But come here quick, okay? Fine. So, do one thing. Go and sit. 10 minutes, I will be there.
No. Okay.
10 minutes, I will join you there. Something urgent happening, okay? You only tell them a hi, quickly tell a hi. Very good. Be there, 10 minutes I will be there. Okay, yeah, that's a good girl. Of lately she has been, you know, trying to do this, I don't know why. I think I need Ali's help to just check why she's been doing this. Very regularly she does it. So, but still okay, by the way, I think we'll continue what we are doing. And I wanted to share with you, you know, what we do today, what happened at the Banjara is that we have our counselors who come to the academy and offer free counseling. So many of them, you know, they deal with children. So they kind of counsel children. So we have career counseling with children. So what we did is that we asked Ali to give us a session on study skills. Yeah. So a lot was, you know, introspected, and there was it was a very interactive session where to study, how to study, how to get in concentration, how to increase your memory, your focus, and also, you know, how to manage time. Children have a very tight schedule nowadays. They have to go for abacus class, then some piano class, and then some tuition class, and then some assignment has to happen, school has to happen, and then they have got some basketball to play. A lot of things keep happening. So in all these things, how to help them out? So we had around 15 participants, and all of us had a very nice session. So it helps us to help children. So that happened. And another thing, you know, for our center counselors, what we did was we have arranged a webinar. So many of them are not able to come on a very regular basis, or some of them really want a lot of insight. So what we have done is we're going to have a webinar where case studies will be discussed with utmost confidentiality, just to understand, you know, that in case something tricky or sensitive comes up, or if somebody else had had a situation like this, what to do. So that is going to happen. And Banjara is known for its counseling and for training. So the course which is going to come up is called Postgraduate Diploma in Psychotherapies. Again, you know, when we meet so many different people, they are from all walks of life. Some are also, you know, they have done their engineering, some have done their law. But then many a time they say that we want to understand people, we want to understand what psychology is all about, the different therapies that are being used. But then they don't want to do a master's in a university. So we have come out and we have been successfully doing it for nearly 5, 6, 7 years now. It's called Post-Graduation Diploma in Psychotherapies. Pan world, wherever any person is, it's an online course. And we have excellent, genuine, diligent faculty members who are such lovely people. They are going to be steering this ahead under the umbrella of Banjara and Ali. So we'll be sending you the posters across. And anyone who you think does not want to get into the mundane of college and syllabus and all, can peacefully do this course. They will be taken through the different psychotherapies. So that is, and I need to go to Sneha. I've asked her to wait. Let me just check why she's being so restless. Ciao, bye bye. Over to Ali with.
Yes, I'm back. And I can see some interesting comments and questions. Let us start off with that. Shobha is back again. I really appreciate Shobha, because whenever we have some conversation, she comes out with something or the other which is thought-provoking. So today, what does Shobha have to say? She says, my daughter, who is 45, has gone through a bad trauma. She seeks attention all the time. I don't have the energy and tolerance at my age of 71 to go through that. Maybe she's feeling insecure or fearful. How do I deal with this, Ali, without hurting her? Shobha, one very, you know, crucial fact is you cannot do it without hurting her. There is a time when sometimes we need to hurt our child as a part of a lesson. So sometimes when we are disciplining, be it a 4-year-old child or a 40-year-old child, sometimes it becomes necessary to hurt the person a little bit. And in that process, teach some sort of a lesson to her. One of the things that I mentioned earlier was the carrot and stick policy. Now, if she is going through a bad trauma and she is feeling a little isolated, or she's had some setbacks in life, obviously, she starts looking around. For any reason, if she does not find, normally what happens, we have some friends, we have some relatives, we have some old classmates or colleagues whom we can connect to. And that disperses our need for attention. But for whatever reason, if there is an adult who feels that I have not really had that type of social contacts and that type of reliable connection, what would she do? Mother is the most obvious person. So she is now, you know, trying to do as much attention seeking from her mother as she can. And the mother, as she told you just now, is not very young and not very fit and agile. She has her own limitations. She's past 70. So she should not, you know, keep on giving in to her. But if you don't give it, the daughter gets very upset. And then the mother's heart breaks that, you know, as it is, my child is going through so much. Now, on top of that, if I, you know, don't give her the basic love and affection. Here, that is why I said, you know, that sometimes we have to hurt. We have to start off with what I mentioned earlier, the carrot and stick policy. When you are nice to me, when you're asking me nicely, when you're showing genuine concern for me and then seeking my attention, I will go out of the way to give it to you. But if you become insensitive to me, like, you know, maybe I need an afternoon nap, but you don't allow me to do that. Or I'm a little tired, I want to watch some favorite serial of mine, but you don't allow me to do that. So whenever I realize that this person, maybe my own daughter, if she is being insensitive to me, then I should become a little more strict. She will get hurt. She'll get very upset. She may cry. She may make accusations that, can't you do this much for me? But the next time that she is good and you reward her, slowly it starts sinking in the mind of the child that this is the way to get attention from my mother. I also need to give her something that she likes. It's a little difficult. It is a little painful even for a mother to behave so strictly with a child who's gone through a bad time in the life. But it is in her interest that you have to do it. You may not be around all your life for her. So she has to learn that I can't lean on to somebody all the time. Surekha says, does attention seeking lead to approval addiction? Yes, Surekha, that is one great fear that it can lead to some sort of an addiction. I have mentioned this earlier, if you remember one of the sessions long back, that addiction is not just to chemical substances or to gambling or to whatever. Addiction can also be to people. And when somebody has this attention seeking, great deep craving for attention seeking, obviously it becomes an addiction. The person feels that I just cannot do without this person. I want all the attention, even if I'm getting 50, 60, 70% attention, I'm not happy. I want 80, 90, 100. So this addiction has to be stopped. And that is again an answer to even Shobha's question, that do not allow your child to get addicted or emotionally dependent on you. So in a way, however cruel it sounds, we have to teach our children, or whoever it may be, it could be a spouse, it could be an elder parent who is, you know, too much of attention seeking, we have to teach it in this manner. Surekha also says, when we are attention seeking, our life is like a constant effort to inflate a balloon that has a hole in it. Very nicely put. It is very difficult to inflate our self-esteem when others do not pay us the attention. Okay. Now, you've used the right word, self-esteem. Very often, this attention-seeking behavior, in my experience, is directly or indirectly connected to self-esteem. If I am complete within myself, if I feel that I am a good enough human being, I am a capable person, I am independent, I can live my own life, I can take care of my needs. If I have that type of feeling, the attention seeking automatically reduces. But if I don't have, somewhere along the line, I have this need. Wonderful example that Surekha gave, that I am trying to blow air into this balloon, but it has a hole in it, I don't even realize it. So I am craving, I'm running behind, I'm trying to get attention of this person, but that person actually starts running away further from me. The person may have wanted to give me some amount of attention, some amount of affection, but when that person realizes that I am chasing that person, person starts backing off. And then I get even more, craving increases, I feel even more lonely, I start going down into a vicious cycle. Teju says, student being disrespectful towards the teacher, does this also mean attention-seeking behavior? Not always, Teju. Sometimes it could be that the student is, you know, angry with the teacher or whatever it may be. There could be other reasons. But if you observe the child closely and you realize that the child has nothing against the teacher, the child is not unhappy with anything, and yet the child is seeking this attention or becoming disrespectful to in order to gain attention, it could be very, very likely possible that the child has realized that I cannot get attention by any other means other than being disrespectful. That could be definitely one of the reasons. Shubha says, so nice, Ali, I will follow the carrot and stick policy. Yes, Shubha, try it out and see. I'm not saying that whatever I'm saying is the ultimate or the only way, but these are some of the things which we can try, and if they succeed over a period of time, but you have to practice it for a reasonable amount of time. Remember that you do it for one day or one week, nothing is going to happen. You have to be patient and consistent over 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks, 5 weeks. You will definitely see some amount of change coming in for the positive. Okay, Fiona says, is self-harming also attention seeking? Sometimes, yes, not always, but there are occasions where a person does self-harm. You know, a person wants to show to the other loved ones or whoever that you are neglecting me so much. If I die, then you will know my value. So I will sit down and write a very pathetic note saying that I think only when I die, you will understand my value and you don't care for me, etc., etc. And then I make maybe a half-hearted attempt at self-harm. I may take a small blade and cut my wrist, or I may do something of that nature. But it is not essentially that I want to commit suicide and end my life. It is to show, is there somebody who cares? In fact, we do even define suicide as a cry for help. Is there anybody in this whole world who really cares for me and to whom it makes a difference whether I am dead or alive? Vinita says, Ali, sometimes children seek attention behavior because somewhere it's registered in their minds that otherwise nobody will listen to them. And I feel it's very deep-rooted and slowly it becomes a habit. Yes, this is what we as adults need to be always aware of. That are we giving out these signals to the children? Are we just taking them for granted? A teacher who finds that a child is very enthusiastic, miss, I've done the homework, miss, I know this answer, and you just say, okay, keep it, okay, be fine. So if you are doing that, then there is a chance that the child will start looking into these behaviors. Even with a parent or an elder, this happens. Small things, the child may come and tell the parent, see, I did this, something very small. The parent says, okay, fine, good, and moves on to some other activity. So that is again a time when the person may start doing disruptive things in order to get the attention. Roshan says, from my personal experience, I can say that attention seekers are basically insecure, as they've had a traumatic childhood or they are over pampered by their parents. Yes, very true. That's what I started off by saying, that a lot of attention seeking behavior develops in the childhood. And if it is not dealt with during the adolescence or early adulthood, a person for his whole life may go. In fact, it may become worse as we grow older. I gave you examples where a person who is retired or a person who is, not keeping very good health or whatever it is in the sunset years, may start grabbing attention, may start using all possible means to get attention, because the person otherwise feels that nobody cares for me. They will start neglecting me. They will not look after me at all if I don't show them that I have my needs. Shobha says, thanks a ton, Ali, for helping me think in another way. Yes, I may not be here for her always. Exactly. So with strict approach, I will be actually helping her in the future to become independent. That's what I meant by saying that sometimes, you have to hurt your own child, but in the long run, you're doing her a great favor. Monitor. If she gets very upset, back off. Then again, pamper her a little bit. Again, slowly get back to the carrot and stick type of thing. It's a long-term relationship, it's a lifelong relationship with your own daughter. So you have to, even if it takes you 1 month, 6 months, 1 year to come to some better understanding and communication, it's still worth it. Teju says, thanks, Ali. And Surekha says, if our number one fear is rejection and our number one need is acceptance, then how do we deal with our fear of rejection when ignored by others? That's a good point that you have brought up, Surekha. Actually, from whom do I want attention? There may be an individual who wants attention only from the spouse. There may be a child who wants attention only from mother. There may be an elder person who wants attention only from her son. Now that is a fundamental mistake that we make. We don't realize that we can get attention from others. Why do we narrow down to some one or specific person and go running behind that person to get the attention? If we can sit back and think that there will be other people who will give me attention. Sometimes I have seen a simple thing that at home, if you feel that I am not getting enough attention from the others at home, getting a pet who gives you such unconditional love boosts your self-esteem so much. And you feel that warmth of that companionship, that here is somebody who pays so much attention to me, who loves me unconditionally, who needs me. I go out and come back and here is my pet anxiously waiting for me. See what a great boost it can be. And that's only one example that I'm giving you. There are so many other ways if you start thinking. But you should have that broad-mindedness to say, I will not put all my eggs in one basket. I will not focus only on one person. I will start looking around from where I can get attention and affection. And I can assure you it is available. Only thing is you have to explore a little bit by trial and error and then you will get it. Shubha says, my students tell me to beat them and blame them for correcting them, but I try them to understand. I am surprised about their behavior and why they want punishment. This is nice of you to share that with us, Shubha. This is exactly what happens when they learn that even punishment or beating is supposedly a way of getting attention. So maybe that is what they found out from their parents. When I'm nice and docile and quiet, parent doesn't give me attention. But if I do something bad, the parent comes to me very angry, says, oh, get me the stick. I want to beat up this person. You sit here. You don't go out. I will punish you. I will do that. So while it sounds very negative, but in a very morbid way, the child is now getting the undivided attention of the parent. And often it goes on for a long time. The parent starts off, or the teacher starts off with one long explanation and one long bhashan about how you are bad, I am tolerating you and whatever it may be. So break that pattern. Tell them that I will not beat you up or whatever, but yes, I will give you a lot of my time and attention provided you come positively. You take one step, I'll take two steps towards you. This is how it goes. There are so many ways in which, as we have discussed, it could start with children. It goes on to adolescents, adults, and even into old age. So it's got nothing to do with that age factor or relationships or something. But one thing I can assure you is that people who resort to attention-seeking behavior can be slowly programmed into bringing about a change. And that cannot be done by force. That cannot be done by putting the person down or, you know, criticizing the person or ridiculing the person. It has to be done in a very gentle and, you know, sensitive manner. Surekha says, when we are needy for attention, others will be able to use this vulnerability to manipulate us. Very well said, Surekha, that when you have this need, I've seen that happening so many times. Let's say there is this lady who feels that nobody loves me, I don't have a life partner, nobody will care for me, I will be very lonely in my old age, whatever may be going through her mind. At one point, if she starts getting desperate for attention and affection from a so-called partner, it is the wrong people who will come to her. It is only people who would want to take advantage of her because they know that she is vulnerable. She's craving for that love and attention and all that. So that is also something. It happens with children when they go out, you know, seeking love and affection beyond their homes and this and that. Somebody outside may take advantage of the child, maybe may molest the child or may take away something which belongs to the child. All these things really happen to us. Shobha says, thank you, Ali. I told them as you told me. Very good, Shobha. I know that you are doing the right thing. I'm really proud of you, the way you interact with your students, and you must keep that up. And these are some simple lessons. For this, you don't need to do B.Ed. or Ph.D. or whatever it is. These are very basic fundamental aspects of life. If we stick to this and if we keep doing this on a regular basis, you know, once we start learning this and implementing it and succeeding in it, we can also be a good role model to others. You can gently tell others that, see, I went through this and this is how I dealt with it. So others can also learn from me. They can also benefit from me. This is how I feel we should spread the message from one to another. As genuine people who care for each other without any vested interest, let us keep spreading this message of whatever these small, small topics that we are discussing from time to time, and let more and more people learn, even one at a time. I'm not looking at numbers, even through this FB Live programs and all that. I'm not worried how many thousands of people are watching or whatever is happening. I'm happy whoever is watching, as long as there is somebody whose life is getting a little bit, you know, improved or changed or becoming more positive. I think the purpose has been served. And that's what I would request each one of you to do. Keep spreading this message. Like in today's session, if there is something that you learned, something that you felt, yes, no, this is a takeaway, don't keep it to yourself. Tell others also about it. Roshan says, being the youngest in the family, got all the love and attention of parents and siblings. So much so that now in my old age, I want to give love to attention seekers. Wonderful. That is a lesson that all of us should learn. Whenever we have got something without having to work for it, whenever we have got these little, you know, bonus or blessings or whatever we have received in life, particularly in non-material terms, I'm not talking about wealth and assets. If we take up that attitude that since I have been very fortunate, let me give it to others. Let me spread this message. In fact, what Roshan said is just an extension of what I was telling you a minute back, that all of us are capable of doing that, provided we have that positive attitude, that generous attitude. And the more we do it, the interesting thing is, the more we feel nice about ourselves, the more we feel complete within ourselves, and the more we feel satisfied. So even if we are not getting some love and attention from others, at times, it really doesn't matter. We can still go ahead happily with our life. Keep that as a simple message and practice on it and spread it to people. So we shall wind up today's program. Shobha says, thank you so much, Ali. You're making me a fruitful, important person to myself. I'm really happy, Shobha, that you're doing this. Each one of you, I feel very, very happy that, you know, you use these means to improve your life and to help others to improve their life. So with that, I'm going to ask Anis to inform you what is our next program. Next Saturday happens to be 16th of September. And as usual, now we have switched over to 2 o'clock. So 2 p.m. on Saturday, 16 September, we are going to talk about people who have a closed mindset. There is a growth mindset where people want to learn, change, develop. And there are things like, you know, a closed mindset where we don't want to change. We want to stick to water. So what happens if you have a closed mindset? What happens if you have an open mindset? What happens if you have a growth mindset? We will discuss all that. If you have any ideas or suggestions or points, please share. Let us have an interesting discussion. Thanks a lot for being there. See you next Saturday. Bye-bye.
Yeah, I wanted to share a few instances what I faced with children around me, that is my own children and plus my neighboring kids and things like that. You know, at times it happens that, you know, I'm over a call or I'm talking to my mother or my husband at home. I can see that my children are playing on their own very happily. They have a good rapport with them. Then they share their toys. But the moment they think that something, somewhere they are missing, you know, to focus on us, they simply start fighting. And, you know, they try to pull each other's toy and things happen like that. And most of the time, not only with children, adults do that as well. You know, appropriately when I'm engrossed in my job and I find that some me time for me, they purposefully want a cup of tea or they want to search for their handkerchief, which they can actually find it in the wardrobe, but they want me to give that. Why? Because they want that attention only for themselves. One more incident I want to share is, you know, when I do some writing for myself or I'm organizing some things at home and assorting few things in the kitchen, they purposefully come in the middle of my work, and which is actually not their lunch time or the snack time, they suddenly start feeling hungry. I'll be like, arey maine abhi to feed kiya tha an hour before, but why? But when I start realizing and reflect on that, I think that yes, they need me to be with along with them and give that attention to. And on the other day, there was a situation when we as a family went on a drive. It was of course after their dinner time, after their milk time and everything, we went. We thought they will, you know, doze off after some time. And myself and my husband, we were in a deep conversation. Then suddenly my younger one woke up. Purposefully she came in between us and she was like, mummy water, mummy kerchief. Why? Because she was feeling a little bit insecure that why mama and dad is talking amongst themselves. Where am I in this?